Watching the Orioles. Watching the Orioles. Watching the Orioles. Watching the Orioles.
Welcome back to Birds Eye View. When it comes to the Orioles, this weekly podcast is your official source for a lack of insight and for baseless opinions. Today is April 11th, 2024. This is episode 386. My name is Scott Magnus.
And I'm Jake English.
And today's show, we're going to take our first trip around the bases in 2024.
And we'll also get in the mood. And not in that West Coast baseball kind of way.
Why not?
It's not that time.
Oh, so I've got to delay myself for 4 hours now? And we're going to do that right after we lubricate the show, which is an appropriate segue. It's time for the drink of the week. Jake, what are you imbibing on this evening?
Well, Scott, I'm double fisting again, appropriately. I'm drinking a gin and tonic with Blue Coat. I'm also drinking a bat mug full of warm National Bohemian.
It seems like a terrible combination.
It is.
What are you starting with there? Like, do you go back and forth or do you do the gin first or like, how does this work?
I started with the warm beer. I was unimpressed enough to move to the gin.
Okay. Gotcha. I was about to say that's very confusing to me of like, I'm going to start with beer and then I'm going to go to gin. Anyway,
decisions were made.
Yeah. I'm doing a Checker Spot Brewing Company. Bird is the word. Honey Kolsch. Pretty good.
Yeah, highly delicious.
Highly recommend checking out Checker Spot before a game in the future. Currently not selling an Adios Angelos, but that'll get rebranded and put out there. But Bird is the Word has been one that has been out for quite some time. It's a lovely, lovely beer to try, especially on a hot spring day, which we have had none of, is the best way to put it. But if you want to know what we're drinking on a daily, weekly, or biannually basis, check us out on Untappd. I'm at MEGN8606.
I'm at JKE4025.
And with that, let's go ahead and stretch out and let's head on over to the medical wing.
I'm going to check your ears, check your eyes, find out how much you've grown.
All right, so let's get into the medical wing and talk a little bit about the ailments that ail us. So CNL Perez is still dealing with an oblique injury. Brandon Hyde indicated that he's starting to feel better.
Great.
I got better. and he's hoping that he can start to throw soon.
Sure. He'll be down a while.
Yeah. I mean, I've listened to enough Bird's Eye View singing about obliques that I know these are not injuries that, in essence, will end up, you know, being solved over a series of a few weeks. This is a, you know, 6+ week injury. We'll see him back probably sometime in May-ish, but for the time being, it was nice knowing you, CNL. We'll see you in May.
we'll always have Perez. Yes. Here's the thing about... You know, I wonder with CNL if it isn't a good thing to reduce the tread that it'll have at the end of the year.
Did he have issues last year basically with like duration or anything?
Just
like that?
Ineffectiveness. Mm. And I wonder how much of that is just use.
That's possible. Speaking of use and overuse and, you know, potentially other aspects as well, Kyle Bradish with his right elbow ouchies, as we call it, was supposed to, in essence, have a rehab start tonight in Aberdeen. But the thing that you hate the most, Jake, the rain.
It won't stop raining in Harford County. It won't stop raining in Harford County.
Well, it's because we're cursed.
It's because I needed dry weather for baseball.
Yeah. But anyway, he is instead going to throw live batting practice or a BP or, you know, something along those lines. That's not going to be a true game. But yeah, I mean, I guess it's cool that he's doing that, but again, you would feel a lot better seeing him in a real life game, as much as, you know, baseball at the single A level is a real baseball
at this point. And you know, I'm not trying to be macabre here, I'm just glad his arm's not falling apart, right? If he goes through an organized throwing activity, doesn't matter to me what it is, if he comes out on the other side of it and they say everything's still attached the way it's supposed to be, fine.
Yeah. I mean, they're letting him get to this point. And yeah. Again, look at Batista last year. They never let him get to that point of, in essence, going out and throwing some real life situations. So
I disagree.
Okay.
I disagree because they did let him get to the point of us just having our hopes up a little. Exactly. Just a little. Just a tid. And I feel like this is the same thing.
We'll get into the segue in a little bit in terms of hope and everything like that. And John Means continues to kind of come back and do some rehabbing down the farm. He pitched today, 3 innings pitched, 2 hits, 2 earned runs, 2 walks, 3 Ks, 1 home run, 61 pitches, 35 strikes, a good mix of fastball and changeup. It looks like fastball was right around 90 to 91 miles per hour. Location was allegedly not great, and that kind of makes sense with that strike to pitch ratio. I mean, he's got 30 days. So again, he doesn't need to be back until, the end of April is the best way to put it. So I think the Orioles are going to take as long as possible before they bring him up. So I think he gets at least 2 more starts. He might even get a 3rd start in the minors just to make sure that he is fully at the pitch count they want him. And just make sure that he's got the touch and the feel for that changeup before he comes north.
Any chance you think they walk him over the parking lot and try to find every pothole they can?
I don't think so.
All right.
I don't think so. I think they might do that with Cole Irvin, but I don't think they're going to do that with John Means.
All right.
Anything else we're missing from the injury wing or anything like that?
I think all things considered, they're pretty healthy at the moment.
Okay. Let's go and figure out who is mad at us in our favorite segment, which is This Week on the Socials. Jake, let's start us off.
I'm going to start over on Blue Sky. This is a post. The post on Blue Sky? We should know this. Here's a post from Leah at LG Trombator. Big fan of this cover, she writes. Hashtag Orioles, hashtag MLB. And it is Baseball America's cover that says Generation Nest, of course, with Adley Rutschman, Gunnar Henderson, and some other guy.
Yeah.
I love all of the national attention. It feels weird.
Feels super weird.
Delightful.
Yeah.
And weird.
Yeah. You can go take the next one.
Next, we have a thread from Kyle Goon, from the Baltimore Manor, of course. I spoke to Cal Ripken Jr. about the number 7, a number he didn't realize until yesterday had been unofficially set aside by the Orioles in honor of his dad. He's glad Jackson Holliday is wearing it again, in part because of its connection to the past, and then a link to the article. Do you buy that Cal Ripken Jr. did not know that the Orioles were not circulating his dad's number?
I believe it. I do believe this, actually. I'm gonna buy into this. I think that, I think when Cal kind of stepped away from the organization as a whole and just was like, Angelus is going to do Angelus's thing, I think he was just like, it is what it is. I kind of buy this a little bit. I think he was probably surprised. He's like, wait, they haven't issued it at all? Not even to a second baseman?
Look, if you're going to buy this, I've got a copy of the Magna Carta for you. I'm not sure that I buy that. But what I do think is that it is interesting that this has happened.
Yeah.
I think when an organization, any baseball team, takes a deeply seated piece of its tradition and makes a change, it's notable, yeah. Right? And so I don't have any problem with it. I think, it was really nice what both Cal and Bill Ripken had to say about it. And one of the things that, Bill said on MLB Network was that it gives them the opportunity to now talk about senior.
Right? Yeah.
And I'm really looking forward to the Orioles doing something in that regard. Somebody on Twitter was quick to remind me that, there's a plaque in the
dugout.
He
is right. There is a plaque in the dugout.
And that's all good and fine. Yeah. But I'd like something a little bit more. I'd like more.
Is there something you're thinking? I'm just trying to. The other aspect, too, it's a weird situation, too, because now you have an owner. And it's, in essence, an owner basically recognizing part of his family. So how big of a deal do you feel about that?
No, I don't feel that bad about it at
all. I don't think I feel too bad at it too. I mean, there is something like when I go to like Ironbird Stadium, for example, and I see the 678 out there and I'm like, are we really wanting to recognize Billy? Like,
all right. In high A, yes.
Oh, in high A, yeah.
At the major
that's
league
fair
level.
Point. That's a fair point.
At the major league level.
That's a fair point.
Not so much.
But yeah, that's a good point. But yeah, like I said, just something to note. We're going to go into Toot, I believe, next on Mastodon, correct?
We are tooting.
And this tweet comes from MLB at MLB. Once again, an MLB account recognizing something the Baltimore Orioles did, kind of. And the tweet goes, or the toot goes as follows. All class from Tony Kemp. And Tony Kemp says, in the fall of 2010, our college had a series against the Longhorns for a 3-game set. Our hitting coach at the time was Josh Holliday, and his brother Matt brought his kid to our early practice. I remember watching his son, you know, Jay Holliday 7, which is Jackson Holliday, with a sweet lefty swing. Go get him, kid.
That's kind of cool. Really classy thing to do.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. That's pretty cool.
He probably knew the story, you know, as soon as he
oh, yeah.
got here.
I'm sure. Right. Yeah. Yeah, it seems like the Holliday family has a lot of, you know, ties into the baseball, which does not surprise me based off how, you know, Matt, in essence, bounced around a little bit in Major League Baseball. But yeah, it's interesting just to see the proliferation of the stories and everything like that. I mean, I think there's a lot of, you know, social media today discussing who's going to be the first pitcher that in essence pitched to Matt Holliday and is going to pitch to Jackson Holliday. So I think those are kind of cool stories to just see, like, all right, there's that fun age gap is the best way to describe it.
Absolutely.
There. Yeah.
All right. I want to go into the Twitters here. This is a tweet from the Baltimore Orioles at Orioles. This is a tweet from March 25th, 2024.
That's a while back.
And it says, coming in with a chip on your shoulder, episode 1 of the next chapter drops next Wednesday.
Yeah.
Scott, it's now April 11th.
Yeah.
And I ask you,
yeah,
what is the release schedule for this next chapter business?
All right. So listen, I'm aware, you know, you have been part of the millennial generation now for quite some time. Jake, back in the day, there are these things called cliffhangers. And in essence, like something would get released and then you would have to wait several weeks, months in order for the next episode to come out. So Jake, you can't just binge through content is the best way to describe it. This isn't the tickety talks, Jake. You're going to have to wait to be patient.
Listen, before we had to wait all the way through the summer, we got 26 episodes.
Jake, you're going to have to be patient here, okay? I think we'll see something in the upcoming week is the best way to put it. I think that we'll see something specifically of, like, there's been a lot of content that has been created, you know, since opening day with Jackson Holliday, you know, being promoted. I think we're going to see a lot in the coming days.
The Orioles organization has come so far in such a short amount of time as far as the quality on the field. And I think that it's media and social productions has also just blossomed. I think the O's are doing a really good job in the production these days.
Yeah, you know, speaking of that standpoint, I mean, I know we give gripes for mass, and there's certain times where I'm, you know, skeptical on this basis. One thing that I've noticed from Masson's standpoint that I'll give them props for this year is they've been using a lot more on-field cameras. And I thought the on-field camera shots that they have used have been pretty impressive. Again, nothing like revolutionary is the best way to describe it, but just like, oh, I'm not used to that. Like, I'm not used to this 1998 technology that you're employing here, but I was glad to see it. I'm like, again, you think about, last night's game where the dongbong was being used, like the camera being right there and just kind of going down the dugout. We've seen similar things at Baltimore as well. But that's just a kind of nice touch that I'd like to see with the new camera system. So
great.
All right. Anything else from this week on the socials or anything like that?
I have nothing else to get social about.
All right. Well, Lynn, let's go ahead and stretch out for the first time this season, and let's go around the bases.
Scotty, it's that time again. Let's go around the bases. Let's start right here at first base, and we can go no further than the topic we've already talked a little bit about with the socials. Jackson Holliday, he's here.
Yeah, we were wrong. Let's just admit it. Like I said at the very beginning of the season, I thought Jackson Holliday was going to start on the opening day roster. He got demoted. We all threw a temper tantrum. We called service manipulation out right on this show. We were wrong.
Yeah. What do you think was the factor?
You know, I think there's been a few folks that have kind of posted on this, but I think people were right when they said, you know, we were going against a bunch of left-handed pitchers and he was going to potentially be on the bench a little bit more often than not. And they wanted to get him a few additional at-bats to kind of keep him hot in Norfolk. And yeah, I think it's as simple as that. It's so interesting because, again, we're so burnt on the past. Like we are here to assume the worst of everything. And when you are surprised is the best way to put it. If it's like, okay, that actually makes sense and it's logical. You're like, okay,
that's weird.
I get it, but it's weird is the best way to put it. So we were wrong. And yeah, I mean, we owe an apology to Mike Elias and to the Orioles organization.
Wait a minute. Is apologizing for being wrong the next chapter of Bird's Eye View?
No, we're just still going to spit out baseless opinions, like I said.
That's what I like to hear.
If we're going to be, you know, a Campbell syndicated show, we've got to just spit out random opinions. But yeah, like I said, awesome to see him come up. You know, great, great standpoint. I'm really looking forward to tomorrow night at Camden Yards. I've got tickets. I'm going to go out and sit there, watch him debut. I'm going to try to get my Jackson Holliday shirt. Really, really, really awesome.
I would be there if I weren't going to be prepping a field that had been rained on again. Thank you, Harford County.
Enjoy that.
But I think it's super cool that he's here. It's also interesting because, you know, in his first game, you know, he didn't really do anything special, right? It was just a regular
RBI ground out.
Just a regular game.
Yeah, RBI ground out and then maybe a missed pop-up, but again, it was a difficult-ish play is the best way to put it. So I'm not going to put that on him.
I just think it's funny. We're used to like, oh, a triple in his first major game. Yeah. This, that, and the other. And it was just like, oh, it was a ho-hum Tuesday.
Yeah. Whatever. I just blame Boston for that. But yeah, I mean, it's good to see. It'll be, you know, interesting to see how he progresses. I think there'll be a learning curve and a pretty steep one for the next, I'm going to say, 100 plate appearances. I mean, I hate to be that negative, but I think it's good that he's starting in the ninth spot. I think it's good that he's going to get a feel for it. He'll get caught up with the speed of it. But it's also interesting to see some of the other, you know, individuals around him kind of talk to him. We'll get into it in the next, you know, base. But I enjoyed seeing one of the baseball players that we're about to talk about be talking to his dad behind the batting cages when Jackson is like hitting and stuff like that. So there's just this little thing going on of like, I think it's going to be a good fit for him on this basis, and we'll see how it goes.
I think you're exactly right that it's great that he's able to, you know, hit in the nine hole with all the talent that this team has. Yes, he is an undeniable star in the making, but he can afford to not be special right on day one.
Yeah, exactly. He can be a above average player in year one. And just see what happens. And maybe he does something like Gunnar did last year, but in reality, he doesn't need to do that because he's surrounded by other superstars.
What do you think is going to be the first thing that happens that makes you go, oh, that's the Jackson Holliday we've been waiting for?
That's a good question. I think it's going to be the speed. I think the speed aspect as it relates to him playing. You know, we'd look at it with Gunnar all the time. Like Gunnar has such speed on the base pass that he's able to extend out additional hits. I think we're going to see something similar eventually from Jackson, where you're going to watch him in the base pass and you're like, oh, he's got a little Gunnar in him is the best way to put it. So that's what I'm looking forward to is in essence, seeing him evolve into a Gunnar like player.
I think for me, you know, it's the, they were saying on the broadcast the other night that it's his hit skill mm-hmm. that's the highest.
Yeah.
For me, I'm going to look for him, you know, down low in the order, just making things happen, you know, hits. Just looking for those doubles that'll eventually turn.
So you're looking for like a Nick Markakis ho-hum performance, basically.
Yes.
Okay.
When he comes up, you know, later in the season after we've gotten through the, you know, the rookie push here.
Yeah.
When he comes up, late in the game, when it matters, down from the bottom of the order, and you're not nervous because it's Jackson Holliday.
Right.
That's what I'm looking for.
Okay. Gotcha. All right. Can we head over to second base now? And let's talk about the other kids.
Yeah. Not the other kids. The other kids.
The other kids.
Because we're talking about Jackson Holliday.
Sure.
A no doubt first rounder.
And so is everybody else in the national media. It's Jackson Holliday. It's Gunnar Henderson. It's Adley Rutschman. And they're talking about the ones.
Right.
The ones.
And I'm, this is probably bias on my part. I'm delighted that Adley Rutschman is still in that trio.
Sure.
Right. Because I think that he's almost easy to forget.
Yeah.
With Jackson Holliday and Gunnar Henderson. But I mean the other kids. And by that, we got to talk about Kowser and we got to talk about Westbrook.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's incredible to watch these guys also be very successful here in 2024.
Yeah, and you know, I think back to last night with Westbrook hitting that, you know, 3-run homer to launch the Orioles into a win. And I also think back to the end of the game celebration with Kowser coming over, dumping some water on him. But again, last night's game was a Kowser Westbrook, you know, mea culpa basically of like Kowser with some great, you know, clutch hitting, you know, also some great fielding plays. And again, you look at these guys and you're like, you know, from a talent level standpoint, they may not be at the same talent level as an Adley and as their Gunner, but you look at them and you're like, they look like they're grinding it out the plate. They're being serviceable from a defensive standpoint. I wouldn't call them all stars is the best way to describe it. I would call them, you know, really good players is the best way to put it.
think about the dark ages, right? If we had players like this come up in the dark ages, I mean, these would be heralded players in the Orioles.
Well, that's exactly right. You know, when I think about players like this, they remind me of players like a Melvin Mora or a Jonathan Scope or someone like that, which are very good players. Don't let me get it wrong. But again, we talked about all the time during Dark Ages baseball was the Orioles did not have superstars. And without those superstars, it's very difficult to win. And again, we saw that in 2012 with Manny coming up. You needed a superstar to kind of anchor the team in order to allow, no offense to Adam Jones, the Adam Joneses to really thrive and not have to be the superstar is the best way to put it.
Just don't tell him that.
I think Adam would admit that to a certain regard of like they needed Manny. But I think, you know, he would admit too, like he was a major contributing portion. And I think I would agree with that as well. But I think it'll be really interesting because people, I think, in essence, written off Colton Kowser based off a very small sample size from last year. But again, he was still a very highly touted prospect. But I think people are just like, well, if he's not a number one, it doesn't matter. So we're starting to see the riches unfold of top 100 prospects now. And you also have a plethora of top 100 prospects that are sitting at Norfolk as well. That could potentially be the other guys. But I do think that Kowser and Westbrook, to a certain regard, especially Kowser, has been overlooked by a majority of the fan base. And now they're, in essence, turning around and looking at it and saying, hey, these guys need to be playing every single day. You know, why are we not seeing them in the lineup?
I'm really glad you said the everyday thing, because I was just thinking to myself, you know, Westbrook particularly has really cemented himself as the everyday third person, right? He's got to be the name written in the lineup every day.
Yeah. And I think there's also, there's a benefit of that too. If like you look at it and coming out of spring training, people were very upset that Cody Mayo was not promoted, but you look at what Westbrook is currently doing, and you look at Mayo, who again is an immense talent, but he still has a 30%+ K rate currently in Norfolk. And again, he's having an amazing season in Norfolk. Don't get me wrong. But again, this allows Mayo to continue to develop a little bit longer at Norfolk, get a field for third base. And then, you know, Westbrook and Mayo can, you know, share responsibilities going forward in the future. So I don't see this as a bad thing. And I don't think any Orioles fan sees it as a bad thing. I think it's great that Kowser and Westbrook are doing it. I think it does start to, you know, cause another awkward situation, which is you have these players that have been on the Orioles for so many years and have been really good above average players. And I think to myself, like a Ramon Urias, I think to myself as an Austin Hayes. And eventually these are the kind of players that, you know, start to get a little concerning to me. And maybe that's where we can go next to on third base.
Yeah, let's turn and go to third. And, you know, I want to ask the question, what is it not too early in the season to have an opinion about? But one of those things is just what you were alluding to, and that is the bench.
Yeah.
Right. The bench right now consists of guys like Ramon Urias and Austin Hayes, who, for better or for worse, are being pushed further and further out by the emergence of the other kids.
Yeah.
Is that necessarily a bad thing? And I ask it in this way.
Mm-hmm.
I know that Austin Hayes is scuffling at the plate right now, but does a really good team have a bench with guys like,
yes,
Ramon Urias?
No on that one, but yes on Austin Hayes.
Austin Hayes. And I guess the next part of that question is, the next round of those, you know, top 100 guys that you're describing, should they be bench players on a good team?
So this is the tough aspect, and this is what everyone's dealing with, which is, like, if you were to promote, I think the big name that is out there right now is not Mayo, but I think it's Kerstead. Like, Kerstead's the name that's like, he's hitting amazing. He was obviously up here at the end of last year. He did pretty well, is the best way to put it. I think Kerstead is the weird one right now of, like, what do you do with a Kerstead if you've got an O'Hearn in that same spot? And I think that's the problem that you're running into. And I'm not advocating for Kerstead to replace O'Hearn, not at all, at this given moment, but that's the weirdness that you're starting to get into, which is, how do you get a Kerstead up here? How do you get a Stowers up here? How do you get a Connor Norby up here, if it's even possible? And I look at that bench spot standpoint, and it's like, well, you could take Urias, but then you also don't want those guys just sitting every single day. So it's a great problem to have in terms of a depth standpoint. My opinion on this matter is, I think the only spot that is, you know, at jeopardy right now is Urias. I think Hayes being on the bench makes a ton of sense. I still trust him as a, you know, kind of platoon bat, is the best way to put it. Urias doesn't do anything for me anymore. I'm sorry. I know he's good defensively. I just think you have so many options defensively. And if you really are in a bind, if you were to trade him or designate him for assignment, you could always bring up Norby in a worst case scenario. So I think we have to start preparing ourselves to walk away from these players that, in essence, have gotten us there. But just, it doesn't make any more sense. You've got, in essence, upgrade, and you have to upgrade to basically get players ready, not just for this year, but for the next 5 to 6 years as well.
I agree with you on Austin Hayes. I think that if you look at Austin Hayes as a much, much more talented Ryan McKenna,
yeah,
that is a luxury to have.
Yeah.
It is an embarrassment of riches. I do disagree a little bit on the Ramon Urias front. I think of him as a poor man's Ryan Flaherty. And
I think he is an expensive Rio Ruiz.
And because of that, I think that he, rather than one of the kids who deserves more playing time, is a better candidate to be the 26th guy. Now, that is an opinion, and I'm not sure how much conviction I have behind it. But
again, what are you using Ruiz for? You're using him as a defensive replacement, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Do you really need him?
I mean,
let me give you this scenario. And again, if you need to switch people up and everything in the infield, that's fine. Worst case to worst, you shift Gunner over to third base in a late inning situation. You put Mateo in at shortstop, and you put Westberg at second base.
Yeah.
Like, there's a ton of, like, this is exactly what we saw last year, where, like, Hyde was able to shuffle his entire infield around in order to make this happen. So, like, I look at Urias and I'm like, it's a nice to have, but in reality, when I look at, you know, a team such as this, I'd rather have a late inning bat that I can pull off the bench. And, you know, we saw that last year with Ryan O'Hearn. I'd rather see someone like that personally.
Yeah, I think, you know, my last plea for a guy like Ramon Urias, and again, like, it's fine. Eventually, he's not going to be an Oriole, and that's going to be what it is. But, you know, if a guy goes down with a bum knee for 3 days,
yeah,
I have no qualms with Ramon Urias playing a plus major league defense.
I don't either. But, like, if that happens and, like, someone goes down with a thing, like, why don't you just, like, DL him and then just pull Norby up? Like, you've got that embarrassment of riches. Like,
Yeah, I just don't want to test it in a pennant race, I guess.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, it just seems so... If you play the game conservatively, I feel like you're going to lose, is the best way to put it. I'd rather just be like, you got to be aggressive. It's not like the Dodgers are looking at being like, well, we really need to have that, you know, secondary utility infielder on our bench. Like,
are you saying that's how we got Tony Kemp in the first place?
Kind of, yeah. I mean, and again, I love Ramon Urias. I hate to say it, but a part of me is just like, it's time, is the best way to put it. It's time. You have to start graduating people. It's time.
All right, let's.
Heck, I mean, if we're talking shortstop, Jackson Holliday could play shortstop if in a really like in a bind situation. I'm not saying he would play it great right now, but he could play it. Like, there is so much versatility in this, you know, in this 26 man roster.
Yeah,
it's unbelievable.
You're not wrong. I mean, we probably do have 2.5 shortstops.
Right.
Yeah. As far as other things that it's perhaps too early or not to talk about, let's talk about the rest of the AL East.
Yeah.
The Yankees are performing well.
They're performing great. I mean, Volpe is absolutely destroying it. Juan Soto, as predicted, is really, really good. And their starting pitching has held up really well to begin the season. I'm not buying it.
Ooh,
I'm not buying it. There's two things I would say to this. Number one, we saw last year with the Rays, and we sat on this podcast and said,
It's over.
There's no chance to get it. And now that we're looking at it and we still see the resilience for this team, I'm like, nope, I'm okay with it. One big thing that folks talked about with the Yankees throughout the entire offseason and coming into the season, they said, the Yankees are one big injury in their lineup away from being a desolate lineup. So, I mean, Volpe has been amazing. I'll be candid. He's been really hitting well. But I just don't see it being sustainable. I think they're one Judge injury away from, in essence, being a above average team, but not the world beaters that they are right now.
And not the team that you have to worry about coming down the stretch.
The other standpoint, too, is it's a weird world that we're living at this moment. Because, again, you know, they started off the season with that 4-game sweep of the Astros. The Astros do not look good right now. Like, they look really bad. So
you hate to see that.
I mean, I don't really care. I don't have the vitriol as it relates to the Astros like most people do. But yeah, I mean, I think the Yankees have been playing great baseball. Don't get me wrong. I just don't think it's sustainable. And I look at, you know, other things that are going on in the AL East, and I'm like, there are much more things that I like with other teams in the American League East and even in other areas of the American League that I think are much more sustainable.
Well, the Orioles and the Yankees will play each other, I think, at the end of this month.
Correct.
That will be an interesting series. Yeah. I will be interested to see what the two teams look like at that point. And maybe by then we'll be able to say it's not too early to have opinions about the Yankees.
Yeah, just keep it close is the best way to put it. You keep it close and everything will be fine. But yeah, I'm not worried about the Yankees whatsoever.
All right. Well, hey, let us round third base. Let's head into home plate. And I want to talk about a few roster issues. Rosteration, always a good thing. The Orioles just made a trade with the Mets, I believe, today for Johan Ramirez, a pitcher who, by the way, was DFA'd for old Orioles friend Cole Sulcer.
Oh, I remember him.
Big deal, so what?
I think so. I think this is big deal, so what? Who cares? He has no option, so he can't go to Norfolk. Unless they like get them and then they transfer through waivers, but I highly doubt that's going to happen if you're doing cash considerations. I think I posted on Twitter. I think this is probably like Jonathan Heasley. He has an option. He'll probably go back down. Mm-hmm. I think this is just a filler arm, is the best way to put it. I think they're going to see what can happen. Maybe this is a Jacob Webb like replacement option, just to see like, can he do something better than Jacob Webb?
And all it cost them was cash.
Right. And who knows how much that was.
Kind of funny to think that the Orioles are just throwing away cash.
Yeah.
Of all the things.
Yeah, well, they've got plenty of it, is the best way to put it. But yeah, this is nothing for me. This is a nothing burger. We'll see what happens. But again, he hasn't been great anywhere. And he's also extremely wild. Like, I think his walk rate this season so far is like 6.9 walks per 9 or something like that. So I'm not feeling it.
I think that Mike Elias, like the first 10 minutes of the Disney classic Aladdin, is searching for the diamond in the rough.
Yeah, well, good luck with that.
The Orioles also claimed for the second time now off of waivers, Livan Soto. Why?
I don't know.
Position players does not seem to be a need of the Baltimore Orioles.
I don't know. I don't get this.
Well, they outrighted him to Norfolk.
I'm pretty sure that this is a game that is being played by like some of the GMs where they've got like a fantasy baseball league. And whoever can like keep Livan Soto on their roster longer gets like bonus points at the end of the season. But yeah, I don't get this one whatsoever.
they're all trying to impress each other with the most absurd move.
Yeah, exactly.
All right. The Orioles 40-man roster is currently at 39.
Is that through the 40?
Maybe it was at 39 for the Soto move.
Yes.
I saw
it. That's what it was.
At 39.
Yeah, so I think it's the standpoint of them getting Soto and then them getting Ramirez, I think maybe puts them at 40.
Brings them to 40.
Yeah.
I have to be honest, I'm a little weirded out by the fact that they were leaving it at 39 for moves like this.
Yeah, I think they always like to do this. I think they always like to have that spot available that if someone comes across the waiver wire.
A Ryan O'Hearn?
It could be anybody. But like I think they always like to have this option to kind of pull it in on that basis. So I think it's interesting. I think the bigger question is going to be, you know, eventually you're going to have to start making bigger moves, and not now in April, but let's call it, you know, late May and early June, you're going to have to make bigger moves. So it'll be interesting to see what the Orioles do and how they, in essence, potentially clear up some of their 40-man roster in terms of getting a potentially a relief pitcher or something like that.
Well, so, you know, going back to the last base, it's way too early, but I have been thinking about, you know, looking at this roster as I've been watching the games this week, looking at the roster, when it comes to the All-Star break, mm-hmm. what's the thing they're going to need? And you think it might be an arm, a bullpen arm.
So I think their biggest need, if I'm being completely candid, and I've said this for the entire offseason, I think their biggest need is a starting pitcher. I mean, you look at it, you look at Corbin Burnes and you look at how good Corbin Burnes is out there. And it just screams to you like, oh my gosh, it is so nice to have an ace on the staff. Grayson's a really good pitcher. Let's call it that. Grayson's a really, really good pitcher, but he's not ace-like like Corbin Burnes. Kyle Bradish is still a question mark. He's still a wild card. And then you've got Dean Kramer, who is nice as, you know, a regular season pitcher. And then you've got Slurvin Curl Irvin, which does nothing for me. And then you've got Tyler Wells, who, again, is fly ball prone and fly ball heavy, which, again, I'm not against. But the way I continue to look at this matter of, like, when you get to, you know, the trade deadline, you're going to want to have someone that you can pitch in the first three games of a DS. And I don't see it. I don't see that third pitcher at this moment. I think you've got Grayson. I think you've got Corbin Burnes, but I don't think you have a third pitcher right now. So if it were me, I'd be doing whatever in my possible way would be to get a starting pitcher that I felt extremely confident could pitch an ALDS game.
That's really interesting because my feeling is less. I'm going to shoot for the moon less, right? I'm less ambitious than that. I think that the Orioles would be best served by the same type of move that they thought that Jack Flaherty was going to be.
Okay.
If they could get another dependable Dean Kramer-like pitcher.
So you want like duration, basically.
Yeah. I want to make an uninteresting but dependable five.
So you might want, or a six, potentially, like similar to what we saw last year. So you want, in essence, like, hey, I can give another day or two off to Grayson or Tyler Wells and in essence not have to have them slough through it.
A guy that's going to give me five or six innings and not give up a ton of runs every 5 days.
So I like that and I appreciate that. I still feel like it's too conservative. And I feel like if your goal is to get to the playoffs, that is absolutely the right move to make. But I think you have to look at this team and look at the Burnes move and say, you're not just playing to get to the playoffs, you're playing to win the playoffs. And I think you've got to go big. And you know, I think I've posted this before, and I think other people have posted it before as well. I think there's only one name on my list, and that's Lizardo. Like, I go off and basically give the Marlins whatever they need in order to me to get Lizardo onto my roster. The sooner the better, especially for how bad they are right now. Like, they are in, obviously, they're in 2018 Orioles mode is the best way to put it.
I don't know how you think we're going to get a talent like that. We just lost Tony Kemp.
We did lose Tony Kemp, but we also discussed it earlier of, we don't really know where a player like Heston Kerstedt is going to play.
You're saying maybe Miami.
Well, Miami's looking for outfielders. So there you go. You've also got Stowers, again, that doesn't have a position. There you go. So again, you've got to start looking at this plethora of riches that you have and start to say, like, okay, I know it's extremely aggressive and it may come back and backfire us. And as we're going to, in essence, no longer have that number one spot in the farm system. But eventually you have to transition from being a farm system to a playoff team.
Hear, hear.
And not just a playoff team, like a dynasty playoff team. And, you know, Lizardo would be under club control for this year and next year. So I think you do it sooner rather than later.
From your lips to the baseball guide's ears. All right, that is our trip around the bases. Scotty, let's step out. Let's take a quick break. And when we come back, I'd like to get a little moody.
Ooh.
Scotty, you and I both have teenagers.
We do.
And we know that sometimes they can be a little moody. Sometimes there can be a mist in the air that you haven't quite earned, but you have to live with anyway. And I feel like the highs and the lows, Birdland can be that way too.
Oh, there's no doubt.
And so I would like to check in from time to time this season on the mood of Birdland. And so I got you something, Scott. It's not a gift. It's a prop.
Okay.
But I want you to take this. It's an Orioles mood ring.
Oh, I feel like I'm back in middle school again.
Absolutely. And so
can I have my pet rock as well while I'm at it?
Not if you want to be within 500 yards of a middle school.
Okay, sounds good.
So we're going to take a look at this mood ring, and I just kind of like to walk through the moods that Birdland may be experiencing.
Sure.
and maybe that you and I as fans are experiencing. And of course, if you don't know Birdland, what a mood ring is,
go ask your parents.
Go ask your parents. Right. It is a ring that apparently is in sync with your aura. It feeds off your very essence. It is an extension of your soul's crying out into the universe. And the color that the rock turns basically corresponds to your moods. And so, Scotty, I'm just looking at this very beautiful mood ring that you just put on your finger, and it's turned green.
Okay, so that obviously means what? Frustrated?
Looking at that would make sense for any other year of Orioles baseball. But looking at the manual, yes, there's a manual. Mm-hmm. Green apparently means relaxed and content.
Yeah, I think that sounds pretty accurate.
What makes you, as an Orioles fan, relaxed and content?
I mean, overall, I mean, you've got a great lineup. You know, it's, you know, struggling a little bit on certain days is the best way to put it. But again, you're coming off a 101-win season. You've got additional players that have come on. Corbin Burns is pitching amazing. And again, it's an extremely long season. I mean, yes, they could be better. But overall, it's been a really nice beginning of the season so far.
Here's how relaxed and content I am.
Yeah.
I have not looked at the standings this season.
Really?
I have no idea.
I definitely have looked at the standings.
I have no idea what any of the five teams... Yeah. I know that the Yankees are on top right now.
Yeah.
Because they're playing really well. I have no idea where everybody else is. Because I do not care.
Yeah, it ultimately doesn't matter right now. It ultimately doesn't matter. I mean, I think it's something just to fun to check in on, just to see, like, how certain teams are doing. But again, you know, you think back last year, You think about the Pirates. The Pirates came out as world beaters at the beginning of the season. So did the Reds, actually. And again, neither of those teams ended up in the playoffs last year. Now, that is the Central, the NL Central, which is, you know, a little weird. But again, even the Rays, like we talked about, came out amazing. And they did manage to, in essence, be right there with the Orioles right up into the end. But again, it's certainly not something that you need to be looking over your shoulder at right now. It's something that you can take a look as a whim, but you shouldn't be worried about it in the middle of April after, what, 10, 12, 13 games. So
yeah,
just relax on that aspect.
Well, Scotty, now that I look into that stone a little more deeply, it seems to be shifting.
It's like turning like an amberish yellow almost.
It's got a swirl to it. It's like an ambery, like beige, millennial beige.
Millennial beige, yes.
And looking at this, you know, the manual, it says that the amber that you referred to is nervous and anxious, whereas the gray is stressed and nervous. And so what are the things as a fan base or you personally that we should be anxious or stressed over?
I mean, I think the most nervous and anxious that I have right now is how am I going to get Apple TV so I can watch the game on Friday night? That's probably what I'm most nervous about at this given time and anxious about.
Is that a planning problem, or is that a thing that where it's like they made the baseball decision and the rest of it doesn't matter?
I think they just made a baseball decision on it at the very beginning of the season, and it just happens to end up to be the game that everybody in Baltimore is going to want to watch on that given date. Or, again, nefarious standpoints, what if Bloomberg has an ownership stake in Apple as a private equity group with the Carlyle Group, and it's just like, you know what? Apple's been struggling lately to hit their revenue numbers. What if we give them a little bump and we have Jackson Holliday premiere in Baltimore on Apple TV?
Either that or they're like, well, we've got to get butts in the seats. How do we do that?
Listen,
let's take the television away from
when them. The patch for Uniform comes out and it's Apple TV as the patch, everyone will know.
It's literally going to be the text of the Magna Carta.
Yeah, exactly.
That's all it is. If I look at the mood ring and I see amber and I see gray and I feel, you know, nervous, I think there's still a part of me that's living in 2012. Mm-hmm. I think that there's a part of me that got so excited with the regular season of 2023, and it was the same old disappointment of having the football pulled out as I went to kick as they got swept out of the playoffs. I think there's part of me that's like, well, what's the thing that's going to keep us out this time?
Yeah.
Right? What's the thing that's going to go wrong this time?
Yeah. What's the shoe that's going to drop is the best way to describe it.
Right. And that's totally irrational. I get it.
And it should quickly fade is the best way to describe it. It should quickly fade and it should switch to another color, hopefully.
Well, I mean, mine is now shifting into black. And if I look at the manual and look at it, it says that black is tense and exhausted. And I think when I think of tension, mm-hmm. I think of some of the Birdland fan interaction. And I wonder to myself,
yeah.
Does the high expectation, does the expectation of greatness, and I think there was an expectation of greatness coming into the season, does this make us as a fan base less tolerant of, one, just regular failures of baseball.
Yeah.
And two, less tolerant of one another.
Yes. There's no doubt. Because again, you know, we look at the Orioles in their first nine games, they finished 5-4, and everyone's just like, uh-oh. It's just like, yeah, but if they finish, I think Connor Nokum posted this for Locked On Orioles. He's like, well, yeah, if the Orioles finished 5-4, though, for the entire season, you know, stretched out over 162 games, they would win 90 games. And it's just like, all right, that's not as good as you would want it to be, but overall, it would probably still get you a playoff spot. So it's very interesting to see me, like, in essence, if the Orioles lose a game, it's almost like, oh, can't believe we lost a game. I think back to that Pittsburgh series, and that Pittsburgh series was brutal with the two walk-offs, but people came out of that on that Sunday like, we lost a series. It's going to go downhill now, and it's just like, you lost a series on the road to a Pittsburgh team that's a pretty good Pittsburgh team. Like, calm down, guys. You're going to lose series this year. But I think there's just this reluctance of believing that they're going to, in essence, always win series. Part of this is on Eric's. Like, Eric's, this is partly Eric, where he comes out every single series and this is like, going to win 2 out of 3, probably sweep. Everyone has this notion now because he's just like, oh, he's being serious. And Eric's obviously not being serious about that whatsoever. But I think people, in essence, have bought into that Kool-Aid and be like, well, of course they're going to win 2 out of 3. And if they don't sweep, it was a bad series.
when the Orioles were terrible, I feel like the fandom was kind of happy-go-lucky.
Yeah.
You know, it was, the stakes were low.
Turning to a few innings, you can tune out. And again, it was that white noise standpoint that we talk about. But now you're living and breathing with everything. Like, even this game that we're watching tonight where the Orioles are down 2-1, like, if the Orioles miss out an opportunity to move some more to second base with, like, Adley and Gunner up, you're like... But again, what did we learn, even from watching games earlier this year and last year? This team's never out of it. So, like, yes, they're going to lose games. Yes, they're not going to come back in every single game. But last year, we saw it all the time. They were the comeback kids. They came back all the time. And we've seen it this year, too.
7 runs last night.
Right. So, again, like, I come back and say, you're going to lose. You're going to lose a lot of games. Even last year, the Orioles lost 61 games. You're going to lose, you know, a good amount of games. Just get above 90 wins. Get into the playoffs. See what happens.
So, Scotty, my mood ring is shifting out of the black. It's lightening up, and it is now a cool, almost tangerine blue. I mean, it's like Caribbean blue. And
like a blue coat, basically.
Yeah, like a blue coat. This evening, yes.
Yes.
And that is calm and peaceful. And I'll tell you what, I am calm and peaceful every 5 days when Corbin Burns pitches.
Yeah.
It is incredible to have somebody like that, that you know that even on a bad day, he's going to give you a really good chance to win.
What an impressive start this week. It just goes to show like how good he truly is. I don't know how much money he's going to get this offseason. I really hope the Orioles like offer him something big to stay. Hopefully he enjoys, you know, everything that's going on.
Hopefully, man, he wants to win his second World Series.
But man, what an amazing pitcher. We knew when we got him that he was going to be really good. I mean, we've seen before with him being a Cy Young winner. He's just so good. Like, it's just, he reminds me so much of like a Mike Mussina, and just in terms of consistency. And it just shows you how long and far away it has been since then.
So I took the chalk. What makes your ring blue? What calms you about this team?
Well, Jake, I think it's an unexpected thing for me. But surprisingly, so far this season,
the Spanish Inquisition,
it's Keegan Aiken.
That's crazy.
It's crazy. But in reality, like, you see Keegan Aiken come into a game. You saw him come in last night. And were you nervous? I was just like, dude's been filthy.
Yeah.
Like, he's been really good. So I've been kind of calm and peaceful for Keegan Aiken as late, which is really weird. But when he came in last night, I'm like, all right, our setup guy's in. I feel good about this is the best way to put it. So, yeah, that's why I'm feeling calm and peaceful right now. We'll see how long that lasts, but it's been pretty impressive so far.
So I'm still chilling here in blue, but Scotty, yours has shifted into a deep purple, like a royal purple.
What does that mean?
That is energetic and passionate.
Well, this is obvious. This is what's been on my head for the past few days. And there's only one thing that can make me so energetic and passionate.
I'm terrified.
The dong bong.
You are excited that the dong bong.
Who cannot be excited? I mean, you saw Kowser hit the double and he does the sprinkler and it's like, wait a second.
I love
it. Is it back? And then they do, you know, turning it on the faucet and you're like, all right, hit a home run. They don't hit a home run that game. You're like, all right, like, is it actually back? And then we get to see it last night with the dong bong back. Yeah.
I love Kevin Brown working it out in real time, like an investigative journalist, absolutely. By the way.
Yeah.
But yeah, so the dong bong is back. It's a good thing. They never should have gotten rid of it. The handbars were dumb. Dong bong forever.
This is coming from a man that disapproved of the dong bong when he first saw it because it'd be bad for the children's.
Yeah. Hey, you apologized for being wrong earlier.
Yeah.
I'll do the same.
That's fine. So I am super energetic, super passionate, and super excited to see the water celebrations back, the dong bong back, and the retirement of the vroom vroom, revving it up celebration, which honestly, it might be enough for me to designate for assignment Cole Irvin, because I think he was the one that came up with it. But yeah, like I said, that's the mood I'm feeling right now.
Well, here. Birdland, let us know what your mood is, what you're reading off of your mood ring, and not just now. Like, we're going to check in all season. What's the mood? What's the mood of Birdland? Tell us about your ring. You can find us all over the socials. Just let us know. And with that, Scotty, the thing that makes me purple, the thing that makes me excited, the thing that makes me passionate.
It's not Dogs After Dark.
It's Fantasy Boss.
And I just gotta keep insisting, oh baby, you sure do swing.
When it comes to kissing, I just gotta keep insisting, oh daddy, you are the king.
Baby, you've got me beat up and down, inside out and across.
All right. So, Jake, you did win this week. So, congratulations. Our category last week was who's going to have the first hit, Ramon Urias or Tony Kemp?
Did I win?
You did win.
Did any of us win in that situation?
Well, Ramon Urias got a hit before Tony Kemp. I believe it was actually the first game after we broadcast. So, congratulations. Ramon Urias broke the streak.
Also, Tony Kemp did not have a hit.
Good.
As an Oregon.
Yeah, that's great.
All right. So it is now a tie.
Yeah.
Fantasy Boss is a dead heat.
Yeah.
And so we have to have some sort of deciding factor.
Sure.
Of course, it's gonna be dongs.
Dongs.
We are going dongs. So Scotty, who is your pick for dongs?
I am going to go with Tony Taters himself, Anthony Santander.
Ooh, it's a brave move. It's a brave move. I feel like chalk right now would be to take Cowser.
Yep.
Because the milkman is delivering.
Yep.
I, however, am going to go with Cedric Mullins.
Oh, that's a bold choice as well. So we'll see what happens. All right. So for this week on Fantasy Boss, it's going to be Jake with Cedric Mullins. I'm taking Tony Taters. We're going to see who will own it. And with that, let's figure out who is good, who is bad, and who is ugly this week in Birdland.
That's right. It's time again for the good, the bad, and the ugly. I'll get started. Scott, I'm going to follow the rules this week.
What?
I got a stern talking to from the listeners last week. I went good in celebration of opening day, and boy,
howdy.
The mail room just exploded.
All three
people
of them
were so upset.
Yeah.
So we'll get a legitimate good, bad, and ugly this week. My good, we have talked about it. My goodness, it is Keegan Aiken.
Yeah.
He's been real good.
He's been real good.
It's funny because when stuff like this happens, you're like, oh, this is why they've been fighting to keep him this whole time when all of us have been ready to, you know, put him on a rail and send him out of town. Okay. Good on you, Keegan Aiken. Please keep doing it. We want more of this.
Yeah. I'm going to go ahead and give mine to Ryan O'Hearn.
I've heard of him.
Yeah. So again, has a 417 average, 533 on base percentage, and a 285 weighted runs created plus. Honestly, if I could do it, and I think I gave it to him last week, I give it to Corbin Burns, but I feel like I'm going to have to give him the Antiobaldo Jimenez ice flow reward. I think he'd be good pretty much every single week, so I'm going to have to stop using him so much.
So he is the anti Terrell Suggs in the Ugly Man.
Yes, exactly.
Okay. Here's the thing about O'Hearn. I think they're using him great.
Yeah.
If you look at the number of plate appearances he has versus the regulars, he is a regular.
Yeah.
But he is just getting enough less to not be exposed and instead to come through in the moments that the team needs it the most. My bad this week is going to go to Tony Taters. Anthony Santander had a 49 weighted runs created plus this last week, a 28.6 K percentage. And the thing is that he has a 316 BABIP. Strikeouts really are the problem at the moment.
Yeah. My bad for this week, I think this is the first time he's ever been on it. Adley Rutschman is in my bad category for this week. In 24 plate appearances, he posted a 227 average, a 250 on base percentage, which is really odd for Adley.
That's suboptimal.
Yeah. So again, from a walk rate standpoint for Adley, 4.2% this past week, which is extremely unlike Adley Rutschman to not take walks. So Adley ended up with a 38 weighted runs created plus. So it'll be interesting to see what's going on with Adley. Is it a plate discipline situation or is he just in a funk right now? But yeah, just not doing well in that two spot is the best way to put it.
And as Adley goes, so does the so does the offense, I wonder?
To a certain, I mean, if you're in the two spot and you've got that currently going on offensively, not great is the best way to put it.
While we're dishing on my boy Adley.
Yeah.
One of the only human characteristics he had, in my opinion, was throwing out runners. Mm-hmm. Continued to not be blown away by this this season.
Yeah.
And I am saying I don't know because it's true. Mm-hmm. I don't know if he is being hung out to dry at some points by pitchers that might not be getting
probably partially
fast enough. You know, there are 1,000 reasons that this could be that there could be external factors, but I would really, really like to see that part of his game improve.
I get it, and I completely agree with you that I think, you know, the pitchers are not helping him in certain instances. But I sometimes feel like the motion that Adley takes and the throws that he make are not great. And sometimes I watch James McCann when he makes throws down to second base, and I'm like, that actually was pretty good, is the best way to put it. So I do agree with you. I think that is I wouldn't say it's a lacking part of his game, but I would say it might be the only below average part of his game that maybe it could be a benefit for him to work on in the future.
It reminds us he's mortal.
Correct, exactly.
Alrighty, where were we? Are we ugly?
We're at ugly
we're
now.
We're ugly. My ugly is simply going to be that the Yankees are off to a hot start. I would like them to stub their toe and fall forever. Don't ruin this for us. This is our time. Just go away.
Yeah. My ugly is going to go to, well, it's the bench that we were talking about. It's Ramon Urias. It's Tony Kemp's. And to a certain regard, it's the Austin Hayes of the world. So Ramon Urias in 9 plate appearances this past week, 26 weighted runs created plus. Tony Kemp, as she pointed out, scored no hits, no walks, no nothing. In essence, he goes down to 0.
Yeah, but that worked for me.
And Austin Hayes continues to struggle in limited sample sizes. Again, got into 5 games with 9 plate appearances and is also hitting an over like Tony Kemp. So it doesn't look good. Like, and again, Tony Kemp has in essence been, you know, released for Jackson Holliday. Jackson Holliday was hitting, you know, 0-0-0 before tonight's game as well. But yeah, like the bench is not good. Like, let's just call it out. Like, the fact that James McCann is your best bench bat, it's not good. It's not good. I mean, I guess you got Jorge. Like, Jorge did have a really nice week this week in spot starts.
Yeah, but April, Jorge Mateo.
That's true.
And every other month.
Once it starts to warm up, Jorge will cool off. But we'll see what happens on that basis, and we'll go from there. So, anything else that you wanted to cover from Good, Bad, and the Ugly?
I think I will stop getting the hate letters. We've gone good.
Yeah.
We've gone bad.
We're actually following the format is the best way to put it. Well, with that, why don't we go ahead and try to blow the save, and we'll start to get out of here.
Scotty, I have a kind of dumb thing I want to talk about.
Okay.
I was perusing Fangraphs, as I want to do.
Are you allowed to do that as a Baltimore Orioles fan?
I'm allowed to do it if I hate everything about it, I think.
Okay.
I think that's how it works.
All right.
So I'm perusing Fangraphs, come across an article by Ben Clemens. It's about the stolen bases. It says the stolen base explosion hasn't continued. Basically, what it does is it talks about the fact that once the rule changes took place last year, you saw an absolute just explosion of stolen bases. And we here in Birdland
saw the same thing,
experienced that.
Yep.
And we thought that Jorge Mateo and Cedric Mullins would steal
60, all 70 bases. Yeah.
All of them.
Yeah.
And basically what this says is that there has been a steep decline in stolen bases. And I'm curious, one, what you think that's about.
Yeah.
And two, why you think that, particularly for the Orioles, the stolen base has not been such a well-used weapon.
I don't know. Like, I don't understand. You know, I think part of it might be they're just being careful with certain players, like a Gunner. But Gunner's been really aggressive on the base path, but like maybe a Mullins is taking a bit more conservative as well. Mateo's obviously not getting as many appearances, but you're right. Like, on a whole, the entire league, in essence, has kind of been reluctant to steal. I feel like we saw a lot of stolen bases during that Kansas City series. But yeah, it definitely seems like the Orioles have put to the back burner utilizing stolen bases and instead utilizing more, try to take an extra base while balls are in play. And maybe that's a decision. Maybe that's an aspect where you're saying like, hey, we think we have a much better chance of getting to another base than in essence stealing a base based off of the probabilities and everything on that basis.
Do you think the improved strength of the lineup was also that they don't want to take the bat out of people's hands?
I think partially. Yeah, I think that's partially right. But I think, you know, Hyde talked about it all spring training and he's talked about it for previous years. Like, he wants them to be very aggressive on the base path. So I'm a little surprised, if I'm being candid, that we haven't seen more. I think it's just time. I think, you know, we talked about the rain situation. It's been cold in a lot of places. I mean, up in Boston, you see all the folks dressed up in coats and stuff like that. I think, you know, with the rain and the cold and everything that's been about, I think maybe they're taking it easy, maybe at this beginning part of the season, not trying to risk the injury bug. And maybe as it warms up, maybe we'll see a few more bases.
This article doesn't hang its hat on this, but mentions that catcher times have been slightly better. And I have to be honest, I just don't buy that. Like, as a factor,
I don't buy it either. I mean, it might be a smidge better, but I don't see anything that makes me think like it's dramatically better. And it's interesting because, you know, we talked about the bases, you know, changing last year. But again, the other standpoint that has come up this year in talking about it is with the 17-second pitch clock now with runners on base, there was this impression that maybe runners could time it better on that basis as well. But again, haven't seen it yet. So we'll have to see as the season progresses, but it's certainly something to note, especially with the Baltimore Orioles, because like you said, you look at the talent on this team, you're like, they should be able to run a little bit more aggressively, but we haven't seen it at all. You know, I think what we've seen maybe two or three stolen base attempts. And then, you know, Gunner has probably been the most aggressive on the base pass, which again does not surprise me. But yeah, let's see what happens in a few weeks when it gets a little bit warmer. That's what I'm going to say.
They may not be stealing bases, Scott, but they have stolen our hearts. And that is our show. Remember, you can find this in our entire catalog of indispensable episodes at birdseyeviewbaltimore.com.
Bird's Eye View is available for download wherever it is you get your podcasts. Subscribe to the show on Apple Podcasts, YouTube Music, Spotify, and many others. Please remember to rate and review the show. We appreciate the feedback and it encourages other people to listen for the first time.
Come and get social with us. You can email us at contact@birdseyeviewbaltimore.com to let us know about your mood ring. You can find us all over social media. We're on Blue Sky. We're on Threads. We have an Instagram account. We're on Facebook, Snapchat. We're on the Ticks and the Talks. But the best place to find us is on a site that used to be called Twitter, where we do something that used to be called tweeting at Bird's Eye View, BAL. And with that, Baltimore and beyond, I will bid you all a fond adieu adieu.
Good night, Baltimore. Be safe out there, and let's go O's. Fun times in Baltimore. Chill out, relax, put the mood ring away for a little bit, and just enjoy some baseball. They're going to lose some games, but it's okay.
Can I still wear the ring?
Of course.
You're still here? It's over. Go home. Go.